Good. Well, good morning.
Good morning.
In the name of the Lord, to the heavens of the Lord, and may the grace and peace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Welcome, Pilgrim Saints of Westdale, children of light, beloved of Christ. It's wonderful to see your beautiful, shiny faces as we gather in the Spirit of the Lord. And I didn't have a chance. I was sort of looking for something in my office, and a couple people came to the door, and I'm so happy to let me know that some new folks are here today. And Rudy came, and Michelle, and somebody named Sarah. Is there somebody named Sarah that walked over from Kawartha Heights? And hey, Sarah, welcome. Welcome. So great to see you. Yeah, I believe there were some others as well. Welcome. I look forward to meeting you and folks from Trinity who have come over the last few weeks, and grace us with your presence, and it's wonderful, wonderful. Grace and peace to you in the name of God's beloved, in whom we share this glorious morning, and whose heart beats here in you, in Peterborough. Arise, children of God, join hands and hearts this day. Alive in Christ, let us live in Christ, and lift the name of Christ with love and gather in Christ's name. Today is Epiphany Sunday. We begin a new season in the church when we see Jesus' holy mission revealed in our scripture readings, in our hymns. Today we journey with the Magi. The Magi visit him, and then we remember his baptism next week, his miracles, his ministry, and his call for us to follow. So this wonderful season of Epiphany that follows the season of Christmas. The season of revealing Christ's mission in our lives. And so we take the vows the pilgrim takes to be faithful to the next step, to rely on more than the map, to heed the signposts of intuition and dreams, to follow the star that only you will recognize, keeping an open eye for the wonders that attend the path, pressing on beyond distractions for your particular path to make. When the road is revealed by turns you could not have foreseen, each choice creates the road that you will take. Take you to the place where at last you will kneel to offer the gift most needed, the gift that only you can give. Because you are created in the holy image, each one of you are God's masterpiece, wonderfully made. Jesus welcomes you here at Westdale just as you are, graces you with an unconditional love, a peaceful rest, and a yoke that is easy and light. So people of God, dare to hope, dare to believe, lift up your hearts, rejoice, give thanks to God. Hallelujah. Amen and amen. I invite you to join with me as we light our Christ candle. Lift up your hearts, rejoice, give thanks to God. Blessed are you, glorious God. We believe in a bright and amazing God. Let us walk in the light of God's love and give thanks. May the love of Christ shine brightly.
Spirit,
join with me in our call to worship. This Christ candle flame dances.
May it give us light.
The light of Christ shows us who we are.
May the joy of God shine from our faces.
One star brighter than the rest led the world to your door.
Raise a star to light our way.
The star of a new word, a gentle touch.
And a passion for every direction, straight into the arms of love.
Glory to you, God of old ways and new beginnings. May our ears hear and our eyes see the ways that every part of your created world sheds.
Hallelujah.
Help us know love and love the Christmas born in each of us today.
Hallelujah.
Let us hold still. Let the Spirit rest upon us. Let us pray. God of grace and God of glory, God of epiphany, you meet us in the warmth and light of a flickering flame, in the laugh of a child, in meeting a new person, in the smile of our neighbor's eyes. You call us to love as we have been loved. You have counted the hairs on our head. Your loving eye is always upon us. Your grace floods this holy place. Your love is amazing. Your love makes us sing. May our voices fill this place from floor to rafter. Rock of faith and vault of grace, you have built us this house where love dwells, built of hopes and dreams and visions. This is a place of welcome, a sanctuary, holy ground where peace and justice shake hands. Epiphany, God of grace, in this moment, all through this day, may we know your warmth and welcome and glorify your name. May we feel your love surrounding us. May we feel your song rising up in us. For your love is a mountain underneath our feet. May the light of Christ's love fill our hearts as we worship together. Let your spark of divine love glow within us once more. Bright and beautiful, God of light and glory, shine upon us. Make this time and this space a holy gathering, an arena of grace, a manger of new birth, a stirring place where Christ is born. In the Spirit of Christ we pray. Amen. I invite you to lift up your voices and join us singing a wonderful hymn, I Am the Light of the World.
Follow and love your learning. join me in the prayer of illumination. God, your word is a lamp to our feet and a light to our path. Spirit of wisdom, sink us a well and let us draw deep. Lord, grant us the ability to think with your mind.
To hear with your ears, to see with your eyes, to speak with your voice.
To walk with your feet, to love with your heart.
Spirit of wisdom, awaken our hearts. In the Spirit of Christ we pray. Amen.
The first scripture this morning is from Ephesians chapter 3, verses 1 to 12. Paul's mission to the Gentiles. Christ Jesus made me his prisoner so that I could help you Gentiles. You have surely heard about God's kindness in choosing me to help you. In fact, this letter tells you a little about how God has shown me his mysterious ways. As you read the letter, you will also find out how well I really do understand the mystery about Christ. No one knew about this mystery until God's Spirit told it to his holy apostles and prophets. And the mystery is this. Because of Christ Jesus, the good news has given the Gentiles a share in the promises that God gave to the Jews. God has also let the Gentiles be part of the same body. God treated me with kindness. His power worked in me, and it became my job to spread the good news. I am the least important of all God's people, but God was kind and chose me to tell the Gentiles that because of Christ, there are blessings that cannot be measured. God, who created everything, wanted me to help everyone understand the mysterious plan that had always been hidden in his mind. Then God would use the church to show the powers and authorities in the spiritual world that he has many different kinds of wisdom. God did this according to his eternal plan, and he was able to do what he had planned because of all that Christ Jesus our Lord had done. Christ now gives us courage and confidence so that we can come to God by faith. That's why you should not be discouraged when I suffer for you. After all, it will bring you honor. Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church.
Thanks be to God.
Our second reading is from St. Matthew, chapter 2, verses 1 to 12. The wise men. When Jesus was born in the village of Bethlehem in Judea, Herod was king. During this time, some wise men from the east came to Jerusalem and said, "Where is the child born to the King of the Jews? We saw his star in the east and have come to worship him." When King Herod heard about this, he was worried, and so was everyone else in Jerusalem. Herod brought together the chief priests and the teachers of the law of Moses and asked them, "Where will the Messiah be born?" They told him, "He will be born in Bethlehem, just as the prophet wrote. Bethlehem in the land of Judea, you are very important among the towns of Judea. From your town will come a leader who will be like a shepherd for my people Israel." Herod secretly called in wise men and asked them when they had first seen the star. He told them, "Go to Bethlehem and search carefully for the child. As soon as you find him, let me know. I want to go and worship him too." The wise men listened to what the king said and then left. And the star they had seen in the east went on ahead of them until it stopped over the place where the child was. They were thrilled and excited to see the star. When the men went into the house and saw the child with Mary, his mother, they knelt down and worshipped him. They took out their gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh and gave them to him. Later they were warned in a dream not to return to Herod, and they went back home by another road. The word, the good news of Jesus Christ.
Thanks be to God.
That's When I thought of this title today, I thought about Paul when I was reading Ephesians. I was thinking about a fellow that I met a number of years ago named Ron Dubes. When I was working at Collins Bay Penitentiary, Ron Dubes was studying to become an Anglican priest while I was there. He was going to Queens the same as me, but through correspondence, and we used to talk. And he used that phrase, he said, it's where the map begins. It's where the journey begins. He used to talk a lot about Paul's mission, how Paul and the book of Acts, in our Bible study on Mondays, we were looking at the book of Acts and how Paul, his name was Saul, and was a terrible persecutor of the church, and in the road to Damascus experienced the scales fell from his eyes. Saul became Paul, this great missionary who said, I have this message for everyone. It's where the map begins, Ron Dubes said, wherever you are, with this message to share. As we heard Karen read so well, Paul talks about being a prisoner in chains. He wrote many of his letters from prison, Ephesians being one of them. Writing to one of the faith communities that he was a part of, helped begin. I thought of Paul this week, I thought about my old friend Ron Dubes. It's where the map begins. Ron Dubes had this wonderful ministry while he was at Collins Bay. He used to send me to his wife's house and pick up boxes of all kinds of literature that he would write and he would translate. He said, my purpose is to share the grace of God. My mission is the grace of God, but it's to translate this mystery of Christ. And so he published all kinds of little books, Snowflake Ministries, Kingston and Big House Songs. He would translate psalms into language. This is Psalm 14. Ain't no big guy in the sky, says the fool, trying to be cool. Believes it ain't solid to believe. And the big guy checks the joint out, looking for those who've got it together. And all the psalms that the Lord is my shepherd, the big guy in the sky is my partner. As I do my time in the big house, he gives me all that I need. Get this bit in. And so he translated the scripture. I thought maybe that's our mission too, to translate this mystery of Christ, this commission of grace. If everybody wants these, they could take the moment. Blessed are the prisoners who step out for those being stepped on. Have an end with being in step. Ron Dubes was quite an intimidating guy. He was kind of a heavy for one of the motorcycle gangs, and he was the guy they would send to get their money or whatever. And he had changed his life while he was in prison, walking. He said down these great corridors and sharing his gifts. Translating this mystery of Christ. And here at Westdale, we translate this message of grace into outreach and love for one another. Commission of God's grace, write a song, write a poem, offer your hand. We translate this grace of God. Years ago, I bought a house in Paris, Ontario. First house I ever owned, the only house I've ever owned. It was one right next to the Catholic Church in Paris. It was a big old house, built, I think, in 1840, and it was a magnificent old house, and I did some work on it. If you look on Wikipedia, if you Google Paris, Ontario, Wikipedia, you go there, and it says, there's a picture there that says, an historic house in Paris. That was my house. And wow, that's my house. It wasn't even the nicest house in Paris, by far. I mean, my mind's there. I thought, boy, from the outside, they didn't have the pictures on the inside. But nice old house, right next to the Catholic Church, and nuns had lived there at one time in the Catholic Church. It was really quite, one of the first things I did when I bought that house was I went up into the attic. It had rained. I wanted to see if it was leaking, if the roof was leaking, but I was mainly going to explore anything, if there was anything up there. Any cool up there? Did they leave? And I remember finding a letter from the young woman who wrote to her grandmother from Saskatchewan, wrote to her mother, grandmother who lived in that house, and it was from the 1950s, and saying, I'm coming for Thanksgiving, and I'm taking the train with my friend, and so I kept that letter, and there was an old shoe there, a woman's shoe, it's all chewed up by squirrels, I think, and newspapers from the Second World War, right after the war. Little bits of history, some pennies, a half-eaten granola bar, we had a robot toy, there was Legos, there was all kinds of stuff up there, and I was looking for treasure. I remember right around that time, this is a few years ago now, there was a report on the news about how full the attic of 24 Sussex Drive was. You might remember former Prime Minister Stephen Harper and Laureen over the years had received some wonderful priceless gifts. What do you do with them all? Do you accept them, of course, but are they yours? I guess the rules are not that clear, but if you were to go up into the attic of 24 Sussex Drive, you would find a diamond and sapphire necklace and matching earrings given to Laureen by Saudi Arabian King Abdullah. You could find a marble-covered book with silk pages and gold thread, a pen from a pope, gold coins, watches worth more than my car. The exchange of gifts between governments is a long-standing tradition. Gifts. What do we do with the gift? They set out to follow a star. How they came to be, we do not know how. The star's light was seen in the darkness. They asked questions. When they were lost, they traveled together. They met King Herod on the way, and they knew he wasn't the one. They bowed down in adoration. They were travelers searching for meaning and finding it in a vulnerable child. They were rich, powerful, educated, and yet they bent their knee to a peasant Jewish toddler displaced from home with his parents. And they offered their gifts. In a dream, they were shown the truth, and they went home by another way. The wise men, whose names we are never told, followed the star. I think perhaps they became wiser as they followed. It was in the journey. I always enjoy the 4-H Club's motto, we learn to do by doing. I think it was in the journey. They became wise. I think they started out being observant. They noticed something. It was St. Francis who first called them kings, but we don't know. The truth is, we know very little about these visitors, not even their names. We do know what they brought. We do know they were wise, and in their wisdom, they believed they had something of a great value to offer, but we know so little. We're not even told they were kings. They were wise. Were wise like you. We're not even told how many there were. Maybe they started out with long robes and high crowns, but the journey was long, it changed them. Like at a wedding, when the ties come off and sometimes the shoes, the dancing begins. We assume there were three because they brought three gifts. We don't know how long it took them to get to Bethlehem or how old Jesus was by the time they arrived. Maybe he met them at the door. An energetic 2-year-old. Maybe he was taking his first steps. For me, the news is not about how long it took, but that it took as long as it needed to take. And the star continued to shine for them and us until we arrive. We don't have to spend years in the library combing ancient texts. There is another way home. The point was something beyond them was calling them, and it was a tug they had been waiting for all their lives. What they were looking for was not on a map. They were the map. The scriptures say they came bearing gifts, but they weren't kings. They were scholars. They were people with questions. There were people looking for hope, people looking for peace. There were people with open hearts, people hearing the whisper of God and being asked a question, by what light do you see me? Are you looking for me? I got a Christmas card this year, and it was of the wise man, and it was his hill and his entourage, his caravan of people, the camels, and just this line of... I think there were more than three kings, three scholars, three royal riders outlined against the desert sky. I think there was a large caravan, magi, servants, supplies, and the like, who had traveled for days and weeks and months, maybe even years. They were pilgrims following star and being guided by dreams, moving together in community. They are a room filled with 60 people, 70 people, in this arena of grace, singing together and praying together. There were much more than three people whose names we do not know. They are us. Because they are people, they are pilgrims. They were people searching for the light of life in their lives and finding it on the journey together. It's where the map begins, wherever you are. You simply don't know that much about them. But that's part of the epiphany. They had no trouble gaining entrance to the palace. They looked like they belonged, and that was enough to get them a royal audience. Only the king they met was something of a disappointment. And they leave Herod's palace, and then the star reappears. There's a lot of silence in our reading today. Herod is afraid. We see two reactions to the birth of Christ, one of joy and purpose and peace, and one of fear. And Herod is afraid. His fear leads to anger, his anger leads to violence, terrible violence, unspeakable violence, staying power at all costs, violence. I'm going to extinguish all the light. And we know what he does. Horror. Our reading stops before we hear, but Herod, when the Magi don't return, Herod will react the only way he knows how. He knows only one way. He is the new Pharaoh. The people will hear the wailing and the crying. Matthew was not the first one to imagine three rich wise men from the east coming to Jerusalem. In Isaiah chapter 60, we find a poem recited to by children of Israel in Jerusalem about 600 years before the birth of Christ. 600 years. The people have been in exile in Babylon, modern-day Iraq, for a couple of generations and have come back to the rubbled city of Jerusalem. They were in despair. Who wants to live in a city where the towers are torn down and the economy has failed and nobody knows what to do about it? In the middle of the mess, an amazing poet invites his depressed, discouraged contemporaries to look up, to hope, and to expect everything to change. Isaiah writes, "Rise, shine, for your light has come." The poet anticipates that Jerusalem will become a beehive of productivity and prosperity, a new center of international trade. Nations will come to your light, and kings to the brightness of your dawn. Caravans loaded with trade goods will come from Asia and bring prosperity. This is cause for celebration. The map begins in hope. It was like they had walked into a big dark room and they were looking for the light switch. The wise men may have wondered if they were the only ones excited about the birth of the Messiah. They had been watching for his star. The scriptures say the Messiah's star rose in the sky, maybe a comet, a meteor. It was a particular star, a source of light in the night sky, and the wise men saw it. And night after night, they scan the dark sky for a flicker of light in a certain spot, in a certain place. And so they followed it, assuming that others were looking for it too. Theirs is a deep wisdom. forever, and for all of us the wisdom that recognizes human life to be a journey, taken in search of the one who calls us beyond ourselves into faithful service, one before whom we are prepared to kneel, and to whom we offer the best of our gifts. Epiphany is the great season of the Church's hope, nurturing hope, of hoping in God. Stargazers, their minds were open toward a world beyond their own. That is, of course, the essence of all true hope, stretching our minds and our faith beyond the confines of what we can clearly see and touch and control. Hope is a way of living that we choose, and gradually, day by day, we learn to be graceful in it. Hope is a way of living beyond our own limited vision and natural fears, of learning to walk even in the dark. The question is, what are we going to do with the gift? What are we going to do with your gift? They risked and they hoped at the same time. As Christians, we have seen something. A light has shined into our darkness. That light is Christ, the light of the world. Having seen the light, we are now called to share the light, to share the good news of Jesus. The wise ones were seekers. They were seeking the same thing we seek, answers to the puzzling dilemmas of being alive in this time in which we have been placed, in the place we have been given. And they did it by following a star on the black canopy of the night sky, in a dark time, confident that something, they did not know what, would lead them somewhere they needed to be. Thanks be to God. Amen and amen. I invite you to lift up your voices and join in singing, As with Gladness, Men of Old.
Yeah.
the Spirit rest upon us. Let us pray. God of all creation, there is a depth here, O God, that is beyond our understanding. A touch that embraces heaven, space flowing with colors of mystery. Lord, we gather together in your name, which is love and peace and joy and hope. And in the light of a new year, we rise to greet you on the path in front of us. Breath of God, breath of peace, breath of love, breath of life, breath of singing, come and inspire us, breath of God. God of goodness and life, partner on our journey, God of mystery and miracle, anchor us in your love, ground us in your peace, remind us of what love's mighty Spirit is bringing. Give us bread for our journey. Unite us in a creative love. Your grace is enough. Your mercy is new every morning. You are the God who sees. This is our hope. You are the God who knows. You are the God who cares. You are the God who loves. And so we pray for courage to face our giants, for strength to overcome our challenges, for joy in all circumstances. We pray for the vision to see what you see. We do not know what we will face, but we do know this: it will never be faced alone. You call us, loving one, from light on new snow, from shadows on mountains to places past the path's curve. We bring before you our wounds and weariness and our hopes from the journey. For all who, like the Magi, are searching for something, we pray. Some for new meaning, some for the right path, some for community, some for your grace, some for forgiveness. For you are the one who gave the Magi the star to follow and the courage to journey together, leading them to a child who would change how they would see themselves. God of light and glory, heal all that is broken in our hearts, in our streets, in our world. In the silence we place all those who we love, trusting in your love that never fails. Shine upon them with healing and with grace. Remind us, God of stars, that the light still shines and you call us to look up. Remind us, God of new birth, that life begins again and again with the gift of each new day. We stand in the field of promise. And may we strive to touch and know the great human heart common to us all. Extravagant, loving God, shine through us and be so in each of us that every person we meet will feel your presence in their soul. Make us, O Lord, channels of your peace. Bless us, we pray, in the name of the one whose heart is peace. We pray in Jesus' name, who taught us to pray together, praying, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Right.
Christ, discover your gifts and share your gifts. Saints of Westdale, the gift of your life is a source of blessing in this world. So let us glorify God through our gifts. With joy we present offerings of commitment and support for the work of Christ Church right here in Peterborough and through the Mission and Service Fund around the world.
$2,000, so it does add up. And so if you would like some information on that, if you're not aware of it, please come and see me after church. Second thing is, there was an announcement in the bulletin about envelopes, about the fact that we did not have envelopes yet. However, on Friday morning, I got a call that they were ready, and I went and picked them up, and they are outside, just outside the door on the table outside the office. So if you have had envelopes in the past, just look for your name. They're in alphabetical order. If you have not had envelopes and you would like envelopes, please see me afterwards and I will set you up. Okay? Thanks.
Thank you, Charlotte. Thank you for everything you do. UCW was meeting. Hey, great. That's Tuesday. That's this Tuesday. And 1:30. Wonderful. That's breakfast. That's coming up Sunday, January the 22nd. We're going to meet. So I should update you on that. The last we've had, how many breakfasts have we had? Two, I think. And at the last one, we talked about the gifts for mission, or those gifts, a little catalog there. And so we've got a number of gifts. I got some suggestions from some of the men. Yeah, so we spent about $100 on different gifts, a food bank up north, and different things. I can let you know about how we. So that's what we did. The guys are so generous. They come in, they bring donations for breakfast, and so this money's been adding up over the last two times. And so we did that outreach there through the Mission Service Book Club, The Light We Carry, Michelle Obama. That's coming up. So that's Friday the 27th. Wonderful. Kim does a great job there, and the Cortha Food Share. Yeah. Wonderful. Yeah, Celebration of Life for Mel Barnes, one of the founding members of the church, and he used to come in and talk to me about, he said, I could see it, the church being built in his mind's eye, and wonderful gentleman. And so this coming Saturday, next Saturday, we're going to celebrate his life here at 1 p.m. Any other announcement? Thanks, Kale. I invite you to lift up your voices and join in singing a wonderful hymn, "Will You Come and See the Light?"
Oh, bet.
April, our daughter's getting married.
Oh, is she?
In Cuba.
In Cuba, hey, why not?